Ja, einen wunderschönen guten Morgen. Der Christian sagt mir hinterher mal irgendwie so 5 Minuten, 10 Minuten vorher mal einmal kurz Bescheid sagen, weil ich habe jetzt keinen Überblick mit der Zeit, weil mein Präsenter-Modus funktioniert jetzt auch nicht. Und hier fehlt die Überschrift. Aus irgendeinem Grund habe ich da vorhin versehentlich wohl so. Auch super, jetzt ist die Überschrift auch da. Sorry. Is somebody in this room who prefers English? Okay, then I will do it in English. So we had a little bit problems with the technique. And you want to discuss database highwayability. So, as usual, my slides are only valid with the talk, not without the talk. So, who am I? Come rein. My name is Susanne Holzgräfe. When you Google or just need for my name, it's very funny, you will find nothing because I married last year or 2 years ago and changed my name. When you Google for my birth name, you will find 120 pages and more. Or my nick is Miracy, you will find also a lot. Today I'm working as senior consultant, senior trainer for PostgreSQL, MariaDB and of course MySQL. I am or was from 2000 up to 2012 or 13. I was part of the PostgreSQL developer team. I developed PostgreSQL, so the mostly parser, and I worked for MySQL and there as developer and later as senior supporter, trainer, consultant, and so on. So I'm one of the two persons in the world who have developing experience at the PostgreSQL project and at MySQL. So I'm active in database business, I guess up beginning of 2001. I'm in open source community since 1996. I started with Debian, and so, I made my diploma in computer sciences. I made PhD studies, and the content was big data, geoinformatics, geodata, measurements of the earth. Yeah, I'm freelancer, and I'm also author, speaker. I write hundreds of articles about that, PostgreSQL, MySQL, and so on. So usually I'm standard speaker. Oh, he said I should not go too far in the corner. So we start with high availability. When you ask for high availability, you usually ask first for backup. So what do you think? Why do you need a backup? Why do you need a restore?
Because server fucks up.
Any other ideas? Why do you need a restore, a backup? So, table drops. So, the Germans call it Wurstfingerfehler also. typical mistakes you make by accident. You wanted to reinstall another server, the test server, but install the production server also happens too. Yeah. So when you lose, for the case that you lost your data. So do you still need a backup when you have a RAID system? Okay, so I think that was clear. What do you need to backup? Do you need to backup your operating system? Or do you just need to back up your data? Do you need, that's the classical questions. What do you need to back up? So usually you don't need to back up the operating system because that I can easily download again and install again and in newer version. So, and on database systems, you also not really need to back up the PostgreSQL or MySQL installation because you easily can reinstall it. What you need to back up are the datas. In databases, you need to back up the data directory or the content of the data directory, and so that you have all your own data and for restore. Hallo? So, how often do you need to back up? Every night, every week, every day? Yeah, depends on, and depends on the emergency or the how importance of the importance of your data. So when you can live with the fact that you will lose one day of data, then you might need backup for just one day. I think the last question, hello. How long do you need to store your backup? Yeah. First, it depends on the law, because we have laws that you have to remove data. We have deletion laws, and so when you have a law that says you have to delete the data, then they should not be in any backup too. So, and when you have a backup from today, and you make a backup next week, and then you make it weekly. So in 2 weeks, you have 3 backups. And you test it if you can restore one of them, the latest one. You don't need the one from today because you have the other two. So you can delete it or override it. So the question is how much backups and or how many backups you need. How many file system backups you need, and when will you reuse or delete them? Don't need them anymore. So I often have this discussion. Yeah, but the data are still in the backup. I said no, because you make a backup every week, and when you delete your data in your original system, even when you make it incremental backups, every night incremental backups. So, and I start today deleting some values, and upcoming night there will be an incremental backup. So my backup won't have them tomorrow, even it won't be in the backup anymore. So I don't need to think about it, how long I need to, or how to get this old data out of the backup. I don't need to store backups for years. I'm not sure in banking business if they really need to store backups 10 years or so, but usually you need to backup, you need to have 2 or 3 backups, and then you can recycle the backup space. And it's a space question. When you have a huge database from 300, 400 gigabyte, you don't want to have a backup from each night, full backup. So in the database world, we decide between logical and physical backup. And now I have to ask, who of you is using MariaDB? Okay, who of you is using PostgreSQL? Who of you is using anything else? Oracle? Oracle. Did you ever use MySQL or MariaDB or PostgreSQL? So, okay. I could ask, who don't know what's a dump? Okay. So, logical backup is a dump. There are advantages from dump. There are also disadvantages. So let's look to the procedure of a dump. I'm still, it's okay to stand here. I don't want to stand in front of my slides. Hallo? This is a timeline, and let's say you make a dump here, for example, at 2 o'clock in the night. Your system do a dump. So you have a dump file from last night, 2 o'clock. And somewhere during the business day, you have a big crash. Flash in the data center, all down. Not even the emergency lights will work anymore or so, or whatever else. Or you did this classical drop table in the wrong terminal or whatever. So you have a crash here. So, and a crash that where you decide that you need to restore backup. Then you can use this dump, and you will have, when you restore the dump, you will have all up to this point, but not the transaction who not finished. So you will have, these are the transactions. I thought about 4 CPUs, so 4 processes who throw transactions to the database. And you see here's this transaction here won't be in the dump, and also this transaction won't be in the dump, because usually the dump, the database systems are doing a snapshot and just take all committed transactions from that time when the dump starts. So you have this and that, but not the unfinished transactions. So, and then you have a big loss of activities. So all data you have had between your dump and your crash are gone. You don't have them. You can't restore them. That might be a full business day. I not said lost data, because I said lost activities, because all what you have done the whole day of your business is lost. So it's also money what is lost, for example. And it's also a lot of time, because you have to do it again. And then after the recovery is done, you can work, but on this, you just have this status here. So you have to redo all what you did between, or maybe you don't need to redo it, then it wasn't important what you did the whole day, but usually you need to redo it. That's a disadvantage of dump. The advantage of dump is that dump is plain, or is usually a plain SQL file, is a text file, and you can zip it, so it's smaller. In any case, it's way smaller than your dot directory when you have indexes on your tables. It's very simple. Of course, you have your data in your dump. So the table, all data in your tables, that space is similar, but you don't have a copy of your indexes, because in the dump you will yet just find create index. So you don't have any already stored data of your indexes, so the dump space that you need is way less than your data directory. The disadvantage is you need to rebuild all indexes, and that can need very, very long time. And especially a dump is using, on the open source database systems, the dump is using a single process. You can use more processes, but each statement is a single process. So a create, you can't split a create index to more processes, to more CPUs. So it's used one CPU per index, per creation, index creation. That's a little problem. So your database will do lots of I/O on recovery. And it might need very long because you need to rebuild the indexes. The second is physical backup. Physical backup means you have a physical backup of your data directory. So you have a copy, you have somewhere a real copy of your data directory. It can be zipped, it can be whatever, but you have a real copy. I made an article and the author and the editor had the idea that you don't need a real copy. I had a big discussion with him. So when you read something odd in this article, it's not for me. And I said, no, you need a real copy. Otherwise, it's not a backup. So physical backup. So what will happen? Is it clever? You just copy the data directory without thinking about it. Just like some backup tools, some file system backup tools doing it. They just take the data directory without anything else. They just copy it in while the database is running. Don't make sense because most of your database is running in cache. The best performance you will get when your database fits in your RAM, so that you have the whole database in RAM. Very often it happens. Most databases aren't that big, and RAM is very cheap. So you have lots of databases fits in RAM. When the database then it's slow, you don't need more RAM because it already is in RAM. So you have a big cache where stuff is in. So when you have a copy from the file system, yeah, you lose all this what's in RAM and you usually can't restore it. The systems won't restore it. So you need to use the products of the database system to make a backup. You cannot do it or not, it depends. You can make a cold backup. A cold backup means you stop the server. You stop the server, shut the server down. In a day, system stop, service system stop. And then the server is stopped. It waits for open transactions. So you have the open transactions too. And then you can make a copy of your data directory. However, you will do it using rsync or whatever else. And after you had a copy from your data directory, you can restart the system again. The big advantage from having a file system copy, a data directory copy, is that you have the information about the transaction log, about the transaction. So the system knows which transactions are already stored on disk and which transactions are still in RAM or just in the transaction log. So database systems usually just store to the disk every 5 minutes per duration. So it's okay when you have a permanent store, when it permanently stores the transactions in the transaction log. So it just logs the transaction changes and every 5 minutes it flush all the dirty pages onto the disk. By duration, it's something more continuant, but 5 minutes is a good value. So what you need, then you can, or you should, it's recommended to do it. You can archive, you can copy, you can back up the transaction log, because then you have all transactions. Transaction logs will be overwritten. At MariaDB, you can Yeah, usually you can configure it. At MariaDB, it's never overwrite a transaction lock, but you will feel it there. Database outside, you will feel it after some hours. That's not a good idea because it needs lots of space. In a good configured PostgreSQL system, the transaction lock will be overwritten every 11 minutes. 10 to 11 minutes. So you need to backup them, to archive them. It means you need to copy the transaction log before it will get overwritten. In MySQL you can say, or MariaDB you can say expire log files. Usually it's set to 3 days or so, depends on your database system. So that you have the transaction logs when you need to restore. So you need to make sure that your transaction logs from the backup all transaction logs that will occur after you started the systems, that you have a copy of them, that you have them. So you need to archive them. And then when you restore, you have here the recovery with all your data, with your backup, that's here. You also have the restore of all the transactions. And so you just have lost activities between the crash and the full recovery, and the system is fully recovered. That's not so much time, so you won't lose what you did the whole day because it's still there. It just will need a few minutes, usually. So it depends how much traffic you have on your system. Maybe 1 hour, maybe half an hour. My experience is a few minutes. I have an example where it was much more, but a few minutes, and then the system has recovered all the transaction logs too, and you can start your working, and your system is up, and you didn't lost something. Yeah, you only lose the transactions that weren't finished at crash time. That's what you lost. And you lose the time for recovery, the administration needs for recovery. That's something, a service time, but it's not the full day. So we once recovered, we had a backup that was 2 years old and we had all transaction logs. And that was on a training at a customer. And we made a recovery. Okay, we didn't look into it. We started the recovery at the beginning, in the morning at 9 o'clock. And before lunch, we looked into it and it was done. So the server was up again and they could use it again. So even when you have 2 years of transactions and just an old backup, it works. Just needs a little bit longer, but it's not the typical use case. Usually you maybe have a backup from the last 3 days ago or last week. Last week already is rare. Often I see backup from last night. So that's, you don't have so much transactions. But as I said, when you have a very old, it also works. So it was cold backup, but cold backup, that means you lost activity. Also here, during your time from your backup, when you have a 300, 400 gigabyte data directory, it will need some time for copy it. I once had a customer, he gave me a service time window from 15 minutes and I needed to copy the directory, 800 gigabyte. I said no. Even the copy needs longer. Even when I copy to the same disk, it will need more longer than 15 minutes. So it depends how big is your database, how long this copy needs. And that's, of course, your business won't do anything. You can't do any business that's database related. So you want to do it hot. That's possible, and that's, you should not just do by copying the file system hot, because you don't know what happens to the transaction between. the backup. So here are transactions going on. So what the open source database systems do, or the systems for the software for it, is they set a flag. I called it that way. They set a flag when the backup starts. And then you can do the backup of the data directory, or you have tools for this, but they usually do async. So there's Postgres where you can do it manually by start backup and stop backup and copy it like you want. And there's a PG backup which use async for data directory, copy and do start backup, stop backup, and backup this. Same with MySQL or MariaDB, extra backup. So you need we set a start backup flag. So that will go into the transaction logs, so that the transaction logs know, here is somewhere in the transaction we have a start a flag here, a backup starts. And when you finish your backup, there is a stop flag. So the system knows, okay, here the backup starts and here the backup stops. And then it knows, okay, these transactions aren't backupped. And this is a standard, this is already in the standard transaction logs, because this transaction finished here. So it's in the transaction log already. So on restore, you just will restore the backup. Then you are here with this, this is wrong, this has to be lilac. Here with the backup. And then you have the transactions that are that happened within the time, during the time that you needed for your backup, between start and stop. And after that, you just can restore all your, or the system will restore all your archived transaction logs, and then you are done. So here you only have, you don't have any activity lost, while the backup is running. You just have lost activities on recovery while you do the recovery. So that's the best way with a minimum on lost activities. The other big advantage is when you think about replications, we will do replications later, you can make a backup from your master system without any loss of performance loss in your master, because you just can do a backup and then restore it on the slave. But that's something we need to speak to. So you have a backup is okay, but yeah, it's like, what will I say? My heating pump. I have a second heating pump somewhere in the cellar, and when my heating pump fails, I have to install it. That's okay. But it would be better to have the second heating pump already installed. Because then I just need to switch the system or so. So high availability. When we talk from high availability, there's a definition about it. And the definition is that you only always have two. When one failed, now that you only always have two systems that are up, where you immediately can switch. That you never have a server by its own. So that's, real high availability starts with three servers. So when one server goes, you still have two servers. It doesn't matter which one is failing, crashing, or you just will have service maintenance work on the servers to do. You still have two others. So when there is the next earthquake, you might have you still have a single server, but it's important that you make sure that not a single server, that you don't have a single server that you always had to. So, replication concepts. We have the standalone server. Yeah. Transactions go writing, reading in a single server. So that's old technique. Warm replication. We don't have warm replication anymore today. That is a kind of log shipping, what they used before replication. Reading, writing, and you have the transactions and the backup and the transactions here. In the, it's already there, it stands by, and the server already is on. So the power, it has power and it's running, but you still need to do some magics that you can use the data. That's warm replication. You have hot replication. Hot replication is reading here, writing there, and you could immediately read from the other node. That's hot replication. And we have master-master. Master-master is you can read and write to both, and they will drink each other. So, MySQL is talking from master and slave. So, where you can write is the master and the others are slaves. But they figured out it's not a good naming, because when the slave gets the master, then it's the master who was slave, and it's just you get confused. The same as PostgreSQL tried it with primary and standby, but you have the same situation when the standby get primary, and now you get confused. So when you switch this more often, then you have two administrators, one don't know, when you speak about primary, you don't know which one is it, the old one, the new one, or the one from last week. So it's better to call it nodes or whatever, give them names to make sure that you are sure you know which one it is, which one. The advantage from such a system, you have one master and one or more nodes that who can read, is you can do a load sharing for reading. You can, all your select queries can share more servers. You can make a load balancing, load sharing, load balancing from it. I have lots of people who want master-master replication. They always ask why. And then they say, yeah, because I have so much write on my server. I want to share it with another server. Yeah, but on write, master-master isn't good. You have double write, because it will write from the direct input, and it would and you have I/O from the input from the other server, so you won't gain any I/O input, nor O. So you just can make load balancing on reading, not on writing, not on these systems. There are systems for write, load, sharing, called cluster, there are cluster systems. For example, the Oracle tool MySQL Cluster, it's not MySQL. MySQL Cluster is an own product. It never was open source, really was open source. It was developed at Ericsson. They do lots of NoSQL in the background. It's NoSQL based. Galera is NoSQL based. So when you have such a cluster where you can share writes, usually it's on the NoSQL level. It's not relational databases anymore. So, then we have asynchrone versus synchrone discussion. I think asynchrone is very, I don't need very long to explain it. When the network is down, your transaction logs here will, your transaction will make a heap and it will get more and more and more. And when the network is there again, all transactions will be sent to the slave or to the other node. By the way, the rule is it's, when we say the master will send it to the slave, it's the same as when we say the sun goes from east to west. The truth is the slave will go to the master and get the, will ask the master for getting the transactions, the changes. It's, yeah, and there the master-slave fits, because the master, the king, never will go to the slave and give him something. So usually the slave has to go to the king and to pick it up, the stuff. So that's how it works, but it's easier to show it that way. So the transactions will go there. Asynchrone, synchrone. Synchrone. Synchrone is funny. By the way, we have it again with this flipping. I think it's something in the wire. Synchronous means you have when you say commit, or usually every writing stating means what you do is doing a commit at the end. Usually it's doing it by automatism. But when you say commit, then on a synchronous replication, the system will make sure that the changes are stored on the disk, on the hard disk of each server before finally you will get back the acknowledgement. Yeah. And what will happen when one of the networks breaks? You never will get an acknowledgement because it never stored on all disks. So synchronous commit can end in endless loop, especially when network is down. So, and you have MySQL called it semi-synchronous. I like this word. Then it not waits until it's stored on all disks, but it waits until it's stored in all caches of all servers. Then you get it. But when you have, even when the network is down here, you won't get back an acknowledge, and you can't you can't work further on. The other disadvantage of synchronous is the speed of light. You can calculate it, and I once heard a talk from Christian Köntop, where he was, I think it was on Fosca, where he was jumping here to demonstrate the frequency. So the speed of light, I had a colleague, Greg Smith, he measured it between Baltimore and Amsterdam. And I once calculated by 15,000 kilometers, you would have 10 transactions, and he measured Baltimore-Amsterdam, 1,000, and figured out 9 transactions. So you will lose lots of performance on synchronous transactions. So here I have what I already told. What's very easy today with the modern open source database, relational database systems, is how to set up a new slave. I still use also the MySQL terms, how to set up a new slave. That's very easy. You can use, you can do a hot backup and archive your transactions, and then you can recover the backup and the transactions. You just need to say start system, you just need to start system, and it will recover by automatism. And then after it recovers all this, it just will, yeah, sync the new upcoming transactions, because the systems, the replication systems, usually make exactly this, recovering the transactions from the original system, so the transaction log from the original system. So, I still, how much time do we have left?
2 minutes.
Okay, it's so long. So, that's my last slide. That's why I ask. Typical setups. What I see very often in my customers, and I have lots of customers, I have hosters as customers who have lots of database customers. So where I have, I help them with the administration of this database customers, and I have telecommunication customers and so on. And what I very often see is that scenario. So they have lots of nodes, lots of more nodes. But they have two nodes set up as master-master replication, but just set up as master-master replication. But the software only needs them for reading. And the read really is done by a load balancer from all those nodes. And they use CoroSync. CoroSync is will give an IP address to one of the nodes. So you have, I just made an example here with 10.0.0.2. So your application, you tell your application, hey, the database system is on 10.0.0.2. And CoroSync makes sure that 10.0.0.2, that node 4 will get 10.0.0.2. So as soon as node 4 fails, or I will do a service maintenance worker, so the CoroSync will change and 10.0.0.2 will belong to node bar. And so the transactions will go in here. And just when foo is back again, when you finished upgrading it or whatever, it will get all the transactions and they have the same level again. So you set up them as master-master for not losing any time. So you just have lost time while the CoroSync is changing the IP address or needs to change the IP address on the nodes. That's a very simple setup. It works fine, and you easily can stop a node, update it, upgrade it, whatever, or upgrade the full server. Sometimes you need to upgrade the operating system because you still have Debian Potato on it or so. So that's a very simple. And you don't need to look into MySQL cluster or Galera or whatever else. PG cluster is there outside too, or MongoDB, CouchDB also. So you can do it with simple relational systems. Yeah, that's my last slide. Questions? Any questions?
Thank you very much for your presentation. It's better to have a synchronous master-master replication in a perfect world. However, the performance, the more you want synchronous, the more you lose performance.
By the way, it's asynchronous, not synchronous.
It's asynchronous,
yes. Sorry, that was something I missed. That's an asynchronous setup.
So the master application?
Asynchronous, yeah.
Okay. So what about the performance? I mean, there is some balance to have between reliability, security of data, and performance. So regarding your experience, how do you deal with this?
I don't. So the question is, what about performance? I don't have any performance loss here. It's lower than 0.01 microseconds. So when you have a replication system master slave, you have there were measurements. It was 1 nanosecond or so. So you don't have any performance.
So excuse me, here in this physical architecture, you still have a write ahead log shipping, isn't it?
Yes.
You still send transaction logs between.
Yeah.
Okay. So that's.
Yeah, yeah. Of course, you have the network speed. Yeah. So
and
speed of light.
What about streaming transactions?
They are streamed. The transactions are streamed.
But between master and master, there is no stream.
There are streams. That are streams. The transactions.
Asynchronous one.
Yeah.
And for example, when I see Postgres, told about Postgres in some. When you see Postgres, you can have synchronous real time replication.
Yeah.
Cause loss of performance.
Yeah.
Some of your customers do not ask for this.
No. No, because synchronous command. My experience with synchronous replication is that when you tell the customers that it will get loose performance as soon as you are not in the same data center, then they say, okay, asynchronous is enough. So I really don't have a single customer doing synchronous replication. Do you have? No. Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Da hinten, ja?
Just
Wait, can you wait for the microphone? It's easier because and speak a little bit louder because.
Yeah, sorry.
Just.
Okay. All right. I'm just a hypothetical setup. I'm just wondering if that works based on what you just showed. Let's imagine I have high availability on two physical machines.
Yeah.
So there is replication.
Yeah.
Between the two, and MySQL, for example, is running on both. One is actually the master, and the other is just there on standby. Mm-hmm. If the master crashes and I automatically fail over to the slave, I might get a situation where some transactions were not committed. So in that setup, if I archive the transaction log, I could easily come back to. My original data, or not. The thing is, if both systems have the same data on disk, they have exactly the same state. But at some point it crashes. Can I recover with the transaction logs?
So the question is, what happens with uncommitted transactions on a crash? And of course, you can't restore any uncommitted transactions. They are just in cache, and they will go back as soon as the crash happened.
Okay.
So, but the advantage for So you never have uncommitted transactions somewhere in the system. So it's always for committed transactions. But when the system crashes and you have uncommitted transactions, they just get a rollback and the user will get back. So something failed and it's just a single transaction. So when you have 100 transactions that are still uncommitted, you will just lose 100 transactions also. And yeah.
Thank you.
Olli vor dir. Der Olli vor dir.
Yeah, so you said synchronous replication between data centers is not good for I/O performance. Is it possible...
In the same data center.
Yeah, is it possible to mix it up, to have full synchronized nodes in a data center and have the same setup in another data center and have an asynchronous synchronization between the two data centers?
So, we once calculated that synchronous is okay when you have 15 centimeters of wires between the servers. So okay. It has to be not, it also has to be in the same rack in the data center.
Okay,
so the question is, why do you need such a replication in the same data center? Usually, when you have a replication, when you have it for availability, you try to have it in another data center or in another room, not in the same room or not in the same rack, on another power network or whatever else. So when you want to do it, so when you ask me personally, I would ask you why you don't use weight.
Oh, we do. In our setup, we're using Microsoft SQL, so yeah. Just to talk about it. We have the same database servers in two data centers on one campus. Mm-hmm. There are 7 kilometers between there, mm-hmm. which is fiber. So yeah. We're talking about 50 centimeters of fiber or copper?
Speed of light, fiber.
Okay. And we have the problem that we have systems that rely on really high availability of the databases. So we have full synchronous data centers on one campus, which is a full synchronous meta cluster, which full synchronous VMs runnings and all that stuff. And it's okay, it's built in Microsoft. And yeah.
Of course, you can do a synchronous replication too between two servers. That's just okay, we do another security aspect. We have synchronous replication. But you also still have the problem, or you need to think about what happens when the wire is defect, the network fails, whatever else. What's when you have a bit going wrong in the RAM? So you have a hardware failure, whatever. When one of the server, you have a synchronous system, you have lots of failure situations. The network can fail, or you in one of the you, something between in the from RAM to I/O can fail, hardware can fail, and you always have that it won't work anymore because you will get back a NUC instead of NUC, and yeah, you have to repair it before it works again, and you will lose all transactions and you will lose your business day in worst cases. So when you have a data center, so usually when you have a data center and you want to change a wire, you need to call the security and so on. It's not that easy and fast. So it's not just, I will call the data center and there will go a student and in 5 minutes all is okay. My experience with tier 4 data centers, it needs very long when you need to have a person really in the data center for security reasons. So, so you can estimate 1 hour before somebody will change your wire. So, and you can't do any business in that time that's related to the database. And then it's a question what happened with your transaction. So I think in that situation, yeah, usually weight is enough in the same data center, because you usually have a weight system too. You have a double power and network. you had network and power replications and stuff like this. So, yeah. Of course, you can build a boat on a house because it could be that the North Sea will come up to here or so. Yeah. Then there was a question.
In some architecture, the replication is done by a middleware, which also offer the load balancing, like Slooney for Postgres. It helps streaming replication with load balancing between master. Do you agree that we can have middleware ensuring load balancing and the replication too?
Replication is streaming.
Yes.
Replication means you stream the log files.
Oh, yeah.
But the load balancing is load balancing. That's the second, that's network technology.
But even Slooney says that it helps for load balancing between reading the two masters. We can have a load balancer, LBR, between the four servers, but just between the master, Slooney says it can help load balancing both.
But Slooney don't have the feature master, as far as I know. You have software from third vendors that offer that you can do load balancing, that you can do replication. That's like my LibreOffice. I can write text and I can write documents or presentations. It's just the same software. They just use different features. And yes, of course. So, yeah. Okay. You had a question? No? I saw a hand somewhere. No. Okay. Then many thanks for your time. I hope you will have a nice weekend at the FirstCon. Enjoy it. And I don't know what the next talk. I hope that the next presenter won't have so much